Okay, guys, are you ready?
Yes.
Yeah, we are.
Okay, now what we want to do, I suppose we basically met every 6 months now online or something like that. My name is Pascal. For those who are now listening to us online or will be in the recording later on, I've been talking to these two, Inusa and Noshin, who started Agribusiness TV about the beginning of the year, basically. And in the middle of the year, we had some feedback already, where you had quite an astonishing number of viewers to talk about. Yeah. We go into that just right now. You can give us a feedback what actually basically happened throughout the year. So you started the whole thing. I'm basically only there to talk to you, to give you what you call a sounding board or something, you know, because I'm a communications consultant working for my own. Now, Agribusiness TV, what was it in the beginning, what you had conceptualized, and what is it now for you too?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I think to start with, it is still the basic idea is still the same. Agribusiness TV is a web TV where we show success stories of young agricultural entrepreneurs in Africa. We want really to show the positive image of agriculture, you know, through the media, which is not often shown. This is what we want to do. We want to show success stories of young people to inspire others to get into agribusiness. So this is the idea we started with, and it is still the same in terms of the idea. But what is different is our, let's say, our expectations. When we conceived the projects, we had, for example, we had set some key performance indicators, like, for example, each video will have max, like, we were expecting 1,000 views
average,
per,
yeah.
Yeah, an average or minimum of 1,000 per video. But today we have videos of nearly 200,000 views, which has really exceeded our expectations. So the attention that the videos got, the way it is being appreciated, this is really something we were not expecting. So, yeah.
And also what it was at the beginning is we started with four countries. And in our mind was to work mainly in this country, but with time we noticed that in other countries we have more interesting stories, but so we just decided to move to cover more countries, because it was not anymore like for us it was we could not stay in just keep working in the four countries. Why? We have more interesting, at the same time, we have more interesting stories in other countries. So that's why also we try to cover more countries.
Yeah, so we changed our focus on countries. It went more on the subject.
Yeah.
If we have an interesting subject in a country where we were not covering before, even if we have to find new partners or new journalists to work with, we make that effort to go there to cover that, because it's worthwhile having subjects that people are interested in, not just focusing on a country where we have seen things already, we might see the same things happening. So yeah, the focus is really on the subject, the story of the person, because in the end, we want inspiration. And even if it is coming from...
Well, the idea is to make young African to travel from where they are. So traveling means that we can bring stories wherever it is to them, so that they have more opportunity to discover stories from where they cannot necessarily visit places they cannot go.
Yeah,
I suppose, I mean, having studied political science and seen all that France Fanon and, you know, all the stories about African borders being drawn by the, you know, the colonial powers, why would that be an interesting part to stick with sort of country rules? You have tribes or groups of people moving along. I mean, so, you know, I suppose the story should carry in that. You do that very well. One thing, do you know Casey Neistat?
Sorry?
the big vlogger from New York, Casey Neistat. So I was wondering if you guys also, he goes to the airport in his videos all the time. If you go to the airport, are people recognizing you as Agribusiness TV people? Is that
it happened in conferences.
Okay.
In conferences, and like people are always surprised when you say your name, and or when they see your name on your badge and say, are you really the one working on Agribusiness TV? So it is okay. They cannot believe.
So you must get your camera out and immediately take some shots, eh?
Yeah. It is happening. I think gradually. At the beginning, you look at the logo, you don't get anything. It doesn't tell anything to you. But now, for example, recently myself, I was in Cameroon for a forum on cassava in Central Africa. And since we cover Cameroon already, there are some people who came and they know exactly. And at one time, I was myself surprised. I was there trying to explain someone what Agribusiness TV is about. But then the other one who has seen us on Facebook came and took my place. They were explaining to the other one what Agribusiness TV is.
Good. Well, was it the same what you wanted to explain, or was it, did they have a...
It was from their perspective, but it was nice to see that they know already that we show success stories through our videos, and they say they get nice ideas. And I think, this is the message also we want to pass on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what is the regional... you have a lot of numbers now. What would you say is the sort of figures in Africa, United States, Europe? I mean, traditionally, you see a lot of United States traffic with anything you do, Northern America. I suppose it's just the students there.
Recently, I was on YouTube. I was looking at individual videos on how they are performing. And for the videos, for example, if we click on analytics, I was seeing that it's mainly African countries. I didn't, surprisingly, on YouTube, I didn't see US appearing in the top views for the videos.
It's maybe because of the French part, eh? Maybe a bit more Canada. Yeah,
might be that.
You can share your screen if you want, but I suppose more impressive are your numbers on Facebook anyway, eh?
Yeah, but in terms of statistics also, we have, in fact, Facebook also, we would say, is one of the channels that has really contributed to what Agribusiness TV is. Because when we look at the statistics for the same videos on Facebook and on YouTube, it is not really the same. Like now we are on the total number of, in terms of views, we are on 1.7 million views. And in that, 1.5 million is just on Facebook. So, the maximum number of views are coming from Facebook. And
because it is easily, people can easily share the videos, and it is more easy to promote videos on Facebook also.
And I would say that our audience also is there.
This is also what we were planning since the beginning. We knew that Facebook should be our, it was what we wanted to do in February when we met with all the whole team in Ouaga to during the inception workshop. We were discussing, and we decided that Facebook should be the main channel of our dissemination. And we were right, I think, now.
And from the beginning, knowing that our audience, online audience, will be there, and because of web TV, if you don't promote your content, it will stay on your website. No one will come and watch it. So we knew already that we have to work a lot on social media, and for Facebook especially, we really worked on the strategy to get the page popular, to push it, get people to like it, because it starts from there. The more fans you have, the more number of views, because each person sharing that video is getting more views.
Yeah, it has been a lot of work, because we try also to identify groups, Facebook groups. Mm-hmm. We have a long list like this Facebook group where we think we can share our videos. So
it depends. We have it per country, and then per country also the agricultural groups. Now, even within groups, there are some groups specific for some commodities, for example, cocoa.
Organic agriculture.
Yeah, like. So it's there are a lot of groups. So from the beginning, we have compiled all everything and yeah. But I would say that at the beginning, like when we just launched the first few months, we had to push a lot on these groups. Yeah. Everything posting on all these, it might look a bit like spamming also, but we had to put it everywhere. But now without doing that, the videos are going automatically.
Easily 1,000 views.
Yeah, in one day you will.
Yeah, that's the way it's supposed to be. Eh?
Yeah.
Yeah, you need some good initial content. And, you know, from my perspective, I don't do Facebook on my end anyway, but for myself, but I would think, you know, Facebook's move to have video content embedded, whatever the special terms are, embedded in their system, you know, to that you can have it launched directly from there. You were right at the right time. Maybe it's a coincidence, but it probably helped you.
Yeah.
Because they just basically, I mean, about a year ago, they basically started to integrate that into their system and basically, you know, getting into the competition there with YouTube and taking that on and Twitter in a way. Mm-hmm. I suppose you were there at the right time, you know, that helps, you know, whether it's a coincidence or not, doesn't matter. And I think you also showed that because you say now it all runs by itself, but I think it's pretty obvious that you need to have some good initial content to get going.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly, because all content doesn't get the same reaction. So it depends on what we are posting. For example, today, say we posted a short video, we will not get the same reaction as a full video report. This one is just, we were doing a test. We were doing a test. We wanted to do a video completely with mobile phone, edited, published everything with mobile phone. So this was a test.
But and it got also 1,000 views.
Yeah,
already.
It got 1,000 views already. So,
which one is that? How you edit a video on your phone?
Yeah, you do
filming and editing with iPhone on smartphone.
Yeah. So we were.
Okay, and that didn't take off or what?
Yeah, it did. It did, but it won't. I think
it is not a complete story. Yeah. So yes, it is. Yeah.
And also, it's a niche. I would say it's like something from Mauritius, typical from Mauritius. So we won't get a big audience like something African, or because people also react to things they can see themselves, they can relate to it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So. No, they're still staying on the content here for a while. If people could create, obviously, their own content, their little agricultural story, mm-hmm. That's basically what Casey Neistat's company BIM was supposed to do, that he just sold to CNN. Mm-hmm. That also basically contributes to something else that I think you do differently. You don't spam people with content that they don't want, maybe, in a way, you know. I think, you know, it's always a question, to what degree are people sharing something widely and it goes viral, but does that mean that you can basically push anything in there? So if you continue to create content, you still need to create content that caters for that interest. Mm-hmm. The longer you go, I would think that the more you can basically live out of that substance. But if you would create shallow content, you could obviously live, now that you started off, maybe for 1 year or maybe even 2 years, you would have still numbers big, and then I would think people will just say, okay, I've seen that, you know. Mm-hmm. It's basically like a TV show that keeps on going and going and going, you know, and then so what is your basically your what would you say is the key cornerstones of your content that drives people to view it or to share it? I mean, we know that there's a difference between people actually viewing stuff or whether they think, oh, it's cool for my friends. I can basically also show off with my friends that they watch it. I mean, there's a thing like that, you know, because you want people to actually take that up and do something with it, but we come to that a little bit later maybe. What would you say are the key cornerstones there?
Did you start with that? Okay. I think our videos are quite particular. It's, first of all, the people featured, the entrepreneurs, they themselves tell the story. We don't, for example, the journalist doesn't relate the story. So this is the first thing that makes it different already. The person himself tells the story.
Okay.
Then the storyline, the way we do it itself, like they start by, it introduces it, because since we cover different countries, the first thing that the video does is to identify where the person is, what the person do, and in which business they are involved in. Then in each video, they also show what innovation, which specific subsector they are in agribusiness, how the business has evolved, what innovation themselves they have brought in, because in each story you will see that they have done something differently that made it work. They saw a gap, they brought in something that worked. And then what benefit and impact their business has had. And also they share some of the challenges they face in their local context. And this one, they each one share a specific challenge. Like it depends on what it is. And then they also share messages, because the target audience is young people, so they share also from the experience what they have to say to young people, what they should be doing, so that if they get into it, it might work for them.
Yeah. I think what we wanted to do is to give to the entrepreneur the opportunity to themselves tell their own story as if they are talking to a friend in front of them. So this is so that there are people who are seeing the video, they can have the feeling like, guys, the guy is just in front of me talking to me. I can feel the story myself. So this is really what we work to have. That's why the journalist he's just filming, but we cannot hear the journalist's voice. Like the journalist is explaining something or telling the story. No, this is something really what makes our content different from what we used to see in TV shows or something like this. So I think, yeah.
Okay, so if I can summarize. No, I can hear myself now.
Yeah.
Why do I hear myself now? Oh, now it's gone. Okay. You basically create the local hero story. So basically, it's not about the entrepreneur, what makes the appeal in a way. It could be your local kid, you know, becoming a hero. And it's sort of accelerated even by being then online. So, you know, because that's cool, that's the way to go. And so you have a cool story to tell about a person that could be me if I would do what he does, you know, if I would just get myself going, get a little bit of help, get a little bit of inspiration. That's the first step. I get it here now online. And then I could, that's basically your approach. So you basically take the people there, and it's I guess from what I've seen, it's not so much about the actual technology applied. It's the fabric that's there, but that's not what the appeal is. Because anybody who will watch it cannot just take that whatever warm coffee or whatever story and just duplicate that. You still have to come up with your own idea. Because that's the competitive market out there. So that's basically the I can see where the appeal is, you know, and there's a lot of local heroes that can make it. So in a way, that's, I suppose, this approach has been done in the Western first world sort of scenario for their audience. So now you do it for an African audience. Mm-hmm. What I find interesting, they're not talking about development cooperation, where you are basically embedded as well, and you're not running you're running that for CTA, if I remember correctly. It's not the classic innovation transfer story. Because what I see is it's got nothing to do with, hey, I've seen online that in the US they take these trucks and they do this or they do that. It's basically, okay, they take little tools that are produced somewhere else. You know, they're not inventing their own hammers or whatever. Or if they need a tractor that's not maybe not produced or manufactured in Burkina or so. But in a way, it's their own story. So it's... Yeah. Yeah. What is that from your perspective? I'm getting off the content track maybe a little bit, but what would you say is there the message for the development cooperation people? Because they seem to be stuck on, hey, we've got this great amount of knowledge here and we want to help people over there and take that up. And then we have to apply it to their situation. But you know what? Yeah, here's all that knowledge. Can you just, you know, please pick it up, you know? Here's your part. Can you formulate a message to the donors and everybody involved in knowledge transfer?
I think for in my opinion it is not wrong in terms of knowledge transfer, because we also produce such type of videos. Yeah. But in another context, not for Agribusiness TV. Recently we did a series of educational videos on the production of local chicken. And that's for a local project in Burkina Faso that aims to build the capacity of women and youth on the production of local chicken. Yeah. So we do these type of videos as well. But this one, the objective of Agribusiness TV is an inspiration. We are focused on each video is the story of a person. Yeah. We can add a face to it. This is how, yeah.
Through this video for Agribusiness TV, it is not mainly about to show people how to start your business in agriculture. This is not the idea. But the idea is to give inspiration from the other experience, to tell the story. This is something that when you see it and you are convinced, you can, and you need to know more about the entrepreneur. Yeah. People are writing us every day to get to get contacts. This is also what we are doing in the background. And I think it cannot be the same thing. Like, we cannot do all in the same content and show people how to start your business. This is completely...
But at least you get a small picture of what's happening in the background.
Yeah.
And then if many people do it already, they ask us for the contact of the entrepreneur. They get in touch and between themselves, they see whether they will collaborate or... Yeah.
Like I was in Côte d'Ivoire at the beginning of December, and someone told me that we had a video on the guy who is doing at the Kuberger.
Okay.
Yeah. Someone told me that he first saw the guy on the Côte d'Ivoire national TV explaining that he is the creator of At the Kuberger. And he did not understand, how can you say you are the inventor of a burger for him? But he said, I understood what he is doing when I saw his video on Agribusiness TV. So it's meaningful to that. The way you are telling the story, it is completely different than the classical channels are doing. So it's also easy for some people to better understand the story of
I think you're downplaying the thing a little bit though. I think, you know, the media creates their own reality. I mean, I don't want to become too philosophical, but what you do is you create the reality for people that believe in that certain things are a way to go. And obviously you have other projects where you transfer knowledge and it's all important. I mean, if I take my papers and where do I apply for that and how do I get things, and you know, and then we all know that in third world countries there's a lot of signatures and all that. But I think still the way you operate with the films, you create something for people that gets them inspired, but it also, and that's what I mean, you're downplaying it a little bit, it does show that people are more interested in stories that inspire than knowledge transfer stories. In a classic sense. So there is a message in it for donors who still stuck on, you know, doing it the classic way. So I'm, yeah, you know, I don't want you to burn your bridges with your sponsors. Yeah.
For example, I myself watched such a video recently, and there are videos that are done in different languages, and the origin, for example, a woman is speaking, and then the translation is being done by a man in, it doesn't fit, you watch it, it doesn't fit with the image, and in this it doesn't like,
okay. By the way, Keron, you can just come on and jump in if you want to ask a question. You don't have to stay on. Just take your opportunity. Unmute yourself and just start talking to us if you want to. Okay. Okay. All right. Okay. Here we are.
Okay. So my question would be, because I am doing something similar, I totally agree with the way that it is being presented, because that is what makes it different and makes people want to watch the program. But I wondered, what about, have you all made any attempts to get the program onto television as an extra revenue stream, since it's already produced? Are you looking to get it onto TV for rebroadcast?
Yeah.
And if yes, how is that going?
Sorry, just a last sentence.
I was asking,
yeah,
how is that going if you all are attempting to get the series onto television?
Yeah.
How is it going?
Yeah. In fact, our immediate plan for 2017 is to get our videos that we did on TV in Burkina Faso. And this one, we just stopped it because end of year, everyone is on holidays, and also we couldn't get it started. But in January, we get back on it, and yeah, maybe you can share, because you're working more on that, and you can share.
The question is,
how do you see it, like?
Okay, yeah, I think the idea is to use the video we had already to build the magazine. It will be something like 26 minutes for each episode. And this, we noticed also for, like, it is easy for us to get advertisement on our content if it is on, like, traditional TV channels. So this is the idea. Mm-hmm. The program we will work on will be supported by publicity. And I think also we think there are some programs we are trying to see different channel what they are doing,
yeah,
and how can we bring something new,
yeah,
out that with our content. So this is really what we are thinking on, mm-hmm, on, and yeah, we don't want to just do something like what, of course, the classical channel, they have their own way to do their program. Maybe,
yeah,
they would say we need it to be like this, but we want to convince them to propose them something new.
Yeah.
And for that, we need also to really...
And there are several steps, like in terms of procedures also, there
exactly
are many, many steps that we have to follow, because since national TV, it's also about the ministry is concerned.
Controlling it, and yeah.
Yeah, but the good thing is that the minister is supporting the idea.
Yeah.
And
they all see so that it is really good content that will be really,
yeah,
useful for the national,
yeah,
TV.
But for now, we are really hoping, and we will push it that so that next year it goes on. But to answer to Keron's question, right now we don't know how it will be, like, really.
We don't know yet, really.
Yeah, on paper we have
we are
concept,
planning to
right?
try. We have the concept on paper, but we know it is always different when you
and the context.
Yeah, and the context, and also the main idea is to build the concept that we can do it in Burkina, and another team like in Cote d'Ivoire can take the concept and select their own video in the among the video we have and build program that will be on the national TV there. So it will be the same like if you have someone introducing the subject, and it will be the main way like we see like in Europe, like some TV like show, like TV. I don't know, The Voice or
the
you
voice.
See, yeah. Like think of to build something like on the same
that
way.
Can be replicated in different countries.
Okay.
Does it answer your question,
Keron?
Yeah,
it does. They have a tough time ahead because I have been trying with these TV stations and they are demanding a lot. They do not want a short web series. They really do want that half an hour long program, and that costs resources that we don't have at Tech4Agri. Mm-hmm. So it's an uphill battle, I would say.
And also, I would say for us, like there are partners who have shown interest, but it's only when we actually do it that we will see whether it's really it's going to translate into action or it was just speeches. So we have to go through, you know, whether.
And we didn't want also to start it earlier, but now I think with all this number of views we have, we can easily negotiate something bigger with them. Say, you see, we have. Already a certain power, but if we did it already into this year, it might be something we may get something less than what we really I think if I don't know if I can say deserve on our work, but taking the time to be going slowly, I think it is also a strategy to get more strength and to get more a bit more confidence so that we can negotiate something big with them. But for sure, we did not have negotiation because the TV channel were also broadcasting on their channels got something, and we need to find ways to raise funds for that.
To do that, we need to put other partners in contact.
Well, national TV in your context, obviously you mentioned already the ministries. There are certain hooks to it, you know, and it gets you into some shallow waters. I would think that what you said, you can negotiate still. I would think maybe you grow your strengths a little bit more before you start negotiating yourself into something. Because for me, TV is a classic recycling journalism tool. They look out, they read newspapers in a way, or watch online or see, and then they produce that. They don't really generate things from themselves, and then they go in there with their marketing power plus the ministerial sort of political power in a way, you know, also Keron, for you, I think, you know, it's quite difficult. I wouldn't sell out too early, because it's not only whatever you want to maybe get in terms of revenue, but also in terms of your format, in terms of where's what we just talked about. Where's your content? Where's your audience? Why do they watch you? You know, what is national TV? National TV might be basically entertainment, info entertainment, basically getting people glued to the screen while the minister comes again on news and so forth. You know, you don't even have to be partisan in a way, but you cater for a different system, and that might be not whatever what you want to do. Keron, I don't know what your plans are there, but I think, you know, there's still some leeway to actually grow your strengths before you start negotiating with them, because maybe then once you're there, there might be some other people coming up with a better deal in a way for what comes from you. And also one more thing, you know, basically myself here sort of thinking here all Christmas time, I feel in terms of the first world, Amazon Prime, they're coming strongly online. So in a way, TV basically gets online. So basically demand driven. You can not only watch now your Google or your Facebook video, you can now get your Fire Stick and whatever is there. And these sort of stations, they will also via Mnet from Cape Town probably coming into Africa at some point, and this sort of system will come as well. And there you probably can be able to target your audience in a different way, and there might be maybe even some opportunities to do something sort of entertaining in a way, but not sort of leaving the entertainment to whatever you don't want to do, you know.
Yeah,
I mean, it wouldn't hurt. Go for it.
Yeah, I agree. We definitely think that we want to build more traction first before we get to television. And also with the format, of course, would have to change when it goes from being a web series to a TV series. So the idea is that we want to still have different segments of the series with different topics. So, for example, a segment looking at women entrepreneurs, and then the segment that we usually do now with Tech4Agri, looking at something that's innovative or something that's happening. And then we also want to have these segments in different islands so that we have more of a regional program, because what we want to do is, yes, we are changing the series and changing up the format to get it ready for TV in the next season. But we still have existing TV markets here in the Caribbean. Every island is a new market. So yes, we are tackling other markets while we are planning for the next season. So the series as it exists, we are going to release it on Facebook and follow suit like Agribusiness TV. Mm-hmm. And let it build some traction, and then let it build some traction on television in other islands, and then we will have the new season that is bigger and better and will appeal to sponsors and to the TV network, especially here in Trinidad, because they are the ones that are demanding it longer and, you know, a bigger production than it is at the moment. So we are making changes, but keeping in mind that we do want to still remain online so that we have those segments, those 3-minute, 5-minute segments can be online rather than a half an hour, something that somebody may not really watch, especially if they are accessing it via social media. So that's the plan, and we do agree in terms of taking our time a bit and not selling ourselves out.
Okay, you want to add something onto it? Otherwise, I want to go back a little bit to the what content pulls the crowds sort of questions, because we were so excited about your success that we moved too quickly. You've mentioned one number, but when I wrote the text for the LinkedIn article that I quickly published with this, I saw that two of your three stories were from Ivory Coast, and then I realized one was talking about chocolate, the other one about burger, and then I thought about clickbait and food. I said, okay, no, maybe this whole thing is a Christmas thing, but you know, now you're starting drinking coffee, so okay. Now I thought, I mean, do you have any idea how that, I mean, we know that the title of a story is critical. You know, sometimes you spend 5 hours editing the footage, and you should actually spend 5 hours writing the title or rewrite it and put it back in. That's why I'm sometimes not so happy when I put the title into the footage itself, because then I can't really change it and on YouTube and change it until people actually pick up the story. Now, over to you. Burgers, chocolate, or Ivory Coast, you know, is there something particular about Ivory Coast and an entrepreneurial spirit? That's the one question. The other one is, how is there a connection between you're nodding around, so give it over to you.
We know what's on your mind.
Yeah, I think, but globally to say it, I think one of the first point is really the originality of the subject. Like for chocolate, we had someone who was working in a bank, and decide to leave his job to produce chocolate from using cocoa, knowing that his country is the world first producer of cocoa. I think this is really something that angers people about this story, like, this is what Africa really needs.
And his story is nice when he says he started in the kitchen of his mother. You can see the kitchen, how he started, and it's a story. Yeah.
With the video ending with the mom giving him advice, like, never forget from where you come from, right? Some things like this, I think,
It touches you.
But sorry to interrupt you. I know a lot of nice stories that have 15 views on YouTube. So that can't be it. You know, it's about marketing. We covered that already. So, I mean, this is sort of a typical ex post argument. You know, you see something, it went well, and then you find the reasons why it went well. That's a bit difficult, because what you mentioned could have been also for some other stories. I agree. It's a very good story. It's very unique. But what about the title and the subject, chocolate and burger?
But yeah, there are more points coming.
okay. Sorry. I lean back.
And let me go on the next one. Yeah. The next one is the first thing you see in the video. If you see the chocolate image, you will see that it's coming from the fountain. And this is something, because if you look at this video on Facebook, as soon as you look at it, you will see chocolate like flowing like this. You would want to see what's in this video. This is the thing that also I think attracts. And it's the same thing with the Atuku burger. The photo, the screenshot on which we have put the title, you look at it, you want to eat it.
People see first food, and we put the video at lunchtime.
Okay.
So food is another aspect to it. People like food, and when they see it, and they are attracted to it. I get the feeling. And we even got these comments for the sandwich one. It was lunchtime. People were hungry. They were watching it. It is not good. You guys published it at lunchtime.
Some were even saying, but I don't feel like eating what they have, but they really want this, what they are seeing in the video. So I think when it is about food also, we notice it is something like that interests more people. But another point is also, we notice that people are more engaged in Côte d'Ivoire. It is about how people also are, if we compare to other countries like Burkina, Benin, like people from Côte d'Ivoire will easily like and share content on video, comment.
They have a different culture.
They have a different culture. Like, they don't.
Well, they when they see something, they will share it. They want to.
Be careful with cultural draws, you know.
It's really nice to see how they share. They are connected. You can see how it happens a lot with videos from Côte d'Ivoire.
Well, don't upset other people here now that might be watching. let me remember when we used Blab before, and I posted then that they actually closed the thing down. Now they restarted it, but I don't know if they're not really having any money. It doesn't work anymore. But that's a different story. But the story connecting to the system Blab is also interesting in that connection. Now you need to follow me. It's a bit of a stretch with the argument, but at some point there were different crowds moving into the system. There were some, I think, Arabic speaking Moroccans that started, and they actually shared the links with their friends because they could hook in and sort of start to learn English while being online. So the whole crowd and the whole system seems to have shifted, and it actually became a point where some people actually didn't want to use it anymore because they, you know, that sort of were too many people just consuming in a way. What my argument is, it's sort of like bubbles, you know, they come up at certain points and you can't really tell whether it's the culture or something. So if in Ivory Coast there's a certain amount of people that are very well connected, they start, you know, your influences, they start picking the stuff up and pushing it, there you are, you know. So in a way, in terms of growth strategy, you probably would have to identify who these people are and emulate that for other countries. You need to find your sort of people. But I guess, Nosheen, you're working very well on online. You probably know that, you know, you probably see the people there. So I'm not so sure if it's about Ivory Coast being culturally different. I wouldn't argue that way. I'm sorry.
It's just an observation. What we have observed with videos from Côte d'Ivoire is really specific. We get it just on videos from Côte d'Ivoire. The number of shares, it's small. You see them tagging their friends coming, tagging others. It's like you can see they speak, they interact more. And mm-hmm. yeah, but I don't know whether it is.
But it is not something that we really see on that way in the other countries, like but even when I was in Côte d'Ivoire, many people, when I met them, they say, okay, when I saw the Agribusiness for the first time, I did not need to know who is behind that. I just like it because I
okay
something really cool, really nice. This is what they are saying, but from what I know in the context of Burkina Faso, people will need to see first who is behind him. Do I know him? And then if I know him, if it is my friend, if it is something, then I like it. You see, I think it is a different culture. Like people will keep watching videos, but they won't like it or they won't share it, but because they don't know who is behind it. You see, this is somebody. But most of the time people don't. It is not that they don't think in the same way. When they really like something, they just share it. They need their friend also to see it because this is,
I can see that. I mean,
last video we posted, I don't know if you know Alpha Blondie, which is the really famous reggae singer. We share our videos, the last video we post. We were really surprised and
The page of Alpha
Alpha Blondie is
and he has like 2 million fans on the Facebook page. Mm-hmm. So
but he's still sharing content for small people like us, initiative like us. So he's also from Côte d'Ivoire. So
I mean, I touched already on this sort of when do people share and like, you know, and they, you know, when I post things that are very much on the communications theory sort of behind that, or for, you know, my clients within GIZ and so forth, very highly specific scientific content, I sometimes, you know, get an email telling me people that they really like that, but they would never click the like button. Or share it, you know. There's lots of people that tell me, you know, I follow you or I hear that, but I don't. They don't do that, you know. I don't know. Some people might have heard, you know, I can be tracked when I do that, or they simply don't have that sort of approach to the medium. You know, they see it on LinkedIn, they watch it, they tell a friend, but they still the like button is something that they, you know, it's. Maybe you want to, maybe there's also a difference in terms of where, when people do that simple act of sharing and liking, it could be different. Maybe you have some ideas on that. What?
I think this one really depends on each individual because myself, it's not even on, it depends on not even context, not even a country. It's a different context. Like I know people in Burkina who, or on Facebook, but will not react to anything. They will just see on the homepage what's happening, mm-hmm. but they will not like or share anything.
And when you meet them, they will say, I saw this video. It is nice.
It is same it was same in Netherlands. I have friends who are there, and they are not doing anything. They are just there to have a profile and see what's happening, but they won't react. So looking at what's happening in different places, I cannot say it is culture, or it depends on the individual, because in terms of privacy also some people don't want to live there, you know, their footprints too much on the web, so they want to stay. Because sometimes when you like public content and all our videos on content, some people also pay attention to that. I don't know if you if you know this feature well, but if a content is public, even if you, your privacy settings is like just your friends can see your publication, when you like this public content, it goes on the homepage of all your friends that you have liked it, because what you have liked is public. Yeah. So this one is another issue. When they see that there is that small globe icon there, people don't like that, because their friends will know that they have liked it. So I know other some other friends who don't like, because they, even myself, when there are things that I don't want to be associated to it, even if I like it, I won't like it.
Friends are not really a problem. I guess it's more your supervisors at work, if you're in a hierarchical institution, what I just mentioned, and you know that your work colleagues, supervisors, future bosses down your career path, and you click the wrong, you know, it's not that they consciously decide against it as such. They just sort of stay this sort of off, you know, this is sort of, you know, they might like Bruce Springsteen or whatever, but they won't do it for work. One thing that comes to my mind to you, you know, talking about this now, if you perceive it like that, why don't you do what lots of the sort of American tutorials, you know, that sort of green screen type of things. And I'm also part of the Social Media Marketing Society there in San Diego. And there was a session lately where they actually talked about that at the end of your video, you should actually tell people in certain contexts to please like or share your video. So it's maybe something for you to actually consider, because as we just said, there are certain crowds that don't really consider that. And you might actually get some of the sort of couch potatoes in that sense off and click, maybe because it's not reflected. They just basically consume and go on. So if you do tell them, give it 5 seconds, in your sort of back part of your video where the music starts hammering and say, please share my video in different languages or something, en français. Maybe that's something to actually crank things up a bit.
When we were starting Agribusiness TV, I remember we did an exercise where we were watching different types of videos from different people who produce videos, and we saw that some, not so many of them, at the end of the video they would share this or something like this at the end of the video, so that it clicks to the person that you can actually share it. But then it was a choice that we made just not to make it look too commercial. We did not put share this in the video, and we also wanted to see how it works. But
you mean like a banner thing that pops up, like, in YouTube? A card.
After Agribusiness TV, everything is done already. Just something pops up like share this video or something like this. But yeah, so.
But I guess it doesn't have to look too commercial if it's a card.
To do some things like bring people to put in their mind that every Tuesday you will have a new video. So it was, I think it's well, because there was this 1 week we did not have videos, and it was Tuesday. People were writing to us to say, it is Tuesday, we are waiting for the new video. Where is the new video? So in there, I think this is also something that, like, put a kind of program in their mind, they know that video, that you have new video at this time, or this is what we try, and we will work more on it for next year.
It's an idea. You could
come on here and tell people, we will launch the next one if we have reached 50,000 likes on this one, otherwise we won't come. So you guys need to push it and share it, and then the next one will come. It's some of the things that some of the people do on Kickstarter, you know, when they get crowdfunding sources. They say, you know, if I've received so many funds from you, then I will do that with my business and share it or whatever, you know. So this sort of idea, I mean,
we really want to try new things, like also invite journalists to pitch the subject, so that on social media the audience will choose, like, for next month we have what are the four main videos you would like to have, and the subject they choose, will be what we produce.
Yeah.
We really need to get mm-hmm. more engagement with our
yeah.
audience.
And we want yeah. more to produce what they are looking for, yeah. what we think is good to produce.
Yeah.
So, and we want more to involve the audience. So this is one of our, what we will be doing in 2017. We will already like have the subjects from the journalists, what they would like to propose. We will.
And I think also it is for the, it is an opportunity for the journalists to have a direct feedback from what the, and for by the time being it is just me who decide, like when they send a proposal I say it is good, I want it or I don't want it. But when it becomes public, like audience say, decide both for the
and why
for the subject they want, the journalists also will know maybe I did feedback. Not pitch my subject well or something like this, yeah. Because sometimes we notice that sometimes we produce a video, we are ourselves convinced that it is a really nice story, but it did not take in the end. Sometimes we see the shooting is not so well, the image is at some point bad, the sound is not that
good,
and then it gets 100,000 views. So it is difficult to predict.
That's a difficult story. You know, people obviously like us, they try to basically come up with all the different factors that make up a good story, the good content. But you know what, I still haven't figured it out. Sometimes I think this is so great and it doesn't, you know, it's marketed and then you should have been at lunchtime Thursday. I mean, you can come up with thousands of different things why it could have been, but in the end, sometimes you really not, it's, you know, you the influences, the, you know, the timing and all that. So you, I think you need to just keep on producing. Eh?
Yeah.
Anyway, talking about content, and you actually did a survey already, didn't you? You sort of asked your audience what you could be done differently. Isn't that what you did?
Mm.
Did you draw any sort of conclusions from that?
No, we did not do that.
Not yet.
In fact,
not yet. Oh, you wanted
started,
to. Okay.
We wanted to each month do an like a public evaluation, public voting to ask them this month, for example, we featured this video, which one you like most. But it was like we use a poll system, so they just had to vote on the video.
Hmm.
But it did not work, so
we did not find it. It was just about like clicking and voting for one video, but what next?
Yeah.
This is, we did not have
answer. Yeah, what do you do with that? Yeah, what do you do with that exactly?
And also at some time we had, it is about, we have this funding, we sit here and we have, we need to go, I think, fast at some point.
Yeah.
So it was becoming too much on us, so.
The thing is that because of these administrative things and all, we had to accelerate what we were doing. Like, for example, we started with 4 videos per month, 1 video per week. And we, at some point, for some months, we had to accelerate. We do two videos per week, which makes it a total of 8 per month. This really was a lot of work. Most of our time was in production, and then we could not focus on evaluation because the plan was to have 3 weeks video. We produce video, we disseminate video, and the 4th week was for the evaluation. But now since this thing changed, we had to produce more videos for a same period of time. We did not have that 4th week anymore where we could take our time, prepare the poll, send it to people, get their reaction. So we lost that 1 week because we had to produce 4 more videos per month.
And that was really too bad. But this is also the constraint when you are
working
funding.
With,
We need to do that, else we will lose the funding. And this is
a reality.
When
you work with grants, sometimes things don't go as planned because the grant says, okay, it starts on this date, that date. But then at the beginning, it starts later than planned. Then when you are in the process, you have to accelerate it. So
now you say you didn't, the comments part, you know, trying to get feedback via clicks and so, and then you have a lot of administrative official evaluation going on. But in a way, it is very important to get that qualitative feedback. You know, because, you know, and I've seen that with many times with projects that I work, they construct questionnaires and I said, well, but what you going to do with, if people answer this, what you going to do with that answer? Because that question, you can only get that and that answer, and what you're going to do with it, because you can't go back and ask them, what did you mean with that? So you need to be careful from the beginning what actually you want to ask. But you do get comments, and in a way you could also even with this video say, well, guys, use the comment function on YouTube, tell us something. And then you obviously you have to sift through what I've seen with lots of people. There's a lot of people that want to just mention their name or something and tell you, great, keep it up, and this doesn't really help you. No matter what you tell them, they will still do that. So how about this? You go and you produce, maybe we can produce a video like this online even. You say we leave it up for 5 days and you leave the comments. We want to hear how actually Agribusiness TV, how did that change what you're doing? Yeah. Don't comment on anything else. Just tell us that. You can send us a video, 1 minute length, 1.5 max, or you write us a comment that you actually, and don't bother with telling us anything else. We leave it out there for 5 days, 7 days, and please tell us. So you set up a small video, launch that, because people will watch that, what you see, and tell us back what you do. And after 5 days, you actually delete that, you take the comments, and you do whatever you want. There's one suggestion how to actually do that.
Yeah, I think this is a really great idea, because like you said, in our mind we were planning to do something like questionnaires and all, and doing it in a video is much, I think it's much more interesting.
It's some days ago or some years ago when we did this on Twitter, it was just one question asking people
with a hashtag.
With a hashtag to give us feedback about Agribusiness TV. One guy just said, I need more than a tweet to tell you my opinion on Agribusiness
TV. He did a video of himself.
So he did a video himself explaining
to relate. So, doing it as a video, I think it is a really great idea. But it is planned also in 2017, another one of our plan is to work on the evaluation, because now we have 46 videos that are online, English, French, and I think it's time, we are almost like three quarter in our first phase. And it is time to do a real evaluation with the audience as well as those who have been featured in the video. So this one, we will have an administrative process of questionnaires and all, but we will have that. We will try to do the video one as well so that we see their comments. But for the time being, in the time that has gone by, we are also, both of us, we are doing our best for each video that is published. Even if it is a lot of comments, we try to go through each one of them to see what they are saying, because like you said, many people leave their comments of how they find the video, whether it is positive or negative, they leave it as comment there. And we have, for example, if people see that in a video someone is using pesticide in a wrong way, they will tell us that, you know, in the video it is done in the wrong way. So we are also careful about all this. When we work with the journalists, they also have, when they see something is wrong at their level also, they should talk to the entrepreneur or see how to the image that we show has an impact. People are watching it and it has an impact. So we have to show the right
thing. And we are also trying to explain at some point our choices, like about, mainly about, we get some comments, some people who are not understanding why the subtitle are really required.
When it is in French,
the guy is speaking in French and we put French subtitles. Some people did not take it well, understand it. And when these European people who are behind it, when an African is speaking French, well, even if it is good French, they will put subtitles. So we had to explain, to clarify that
why
we are doing it, and it is not even a European team, we are all African working on the videos.
Yeah.
And also, yes, when you were in Cameroon, you get...
In fact, I was in Cameroon again for that cassava forum. A journalist, she's a young girl, she came and wanted to have an interview because she liked the idea of Agribusiness TV. So I was with her, we did the interview already. I did not notice anything, everything went really well. So at the end of the interview, she told me that she really appreciated that we subtitled all our videos, because actually she cannot hear well. She cannot hear well, and because of that, she cannot watch all videos. So that helped her a lot in understanding easily our videos. And this is one example. Mm-hmm. Another one is, right now we are in Mauritius, and we speak French here, but sometimes we don't understand French accent from Africa. For example, last week there was a TV serial from Cameroon, and it was French on... And the thing is that
no one was
understanding the French because the accent is completely different.
Yeah.
So we sometimes it's difficult for our audience to understand that it's not because we don't understand their French or we think that they don't speak well that we subtitle, but we want it to be understood by everyone. And also another girl from Germany itself told me that she watches video in the metro. So she doesn't put sound in it. She just watches the images, and this helps her to watch the videos. So these are the types of...
Yeah.
Of...
And I think since the beginning we said we need to subtitle it, because even if it is just one person, because who will for whom it will be useful, we need to do it because we want our video to be everyone who is interested to get access to it.
Yeah.
So it is a choice, and we cannot leave this comment like we need to work to explain people so that they can better and to explain them very politely, even if sometimes their comment is really insulting. So this is what we are doing, and when they understand, they come back and say, okay, sorry, I did not get
that,
but now I understand why.
And sometimes they say things make us think, and if we can, we will certainly rectify it next time.
Yeah.
So these comments, when they share something or they write a comment, it's really useful.
Yeah.
So far, it has been really useful.
The comments are obviously difficult, and I think, you know, if you have a large audience like you have, you will have a certain amount of people that are, you know, there's a certain amount of people that are weird, whatever you name it.
Sound,
you know,
again.
No sound.
If someone
sound.
Puts it in writing, it blows it out of. Okay, so obviously there's a lot you can talk about comments with people, and you shouldn't run after too many of them because it's blown out of proportion. You don't know how many people actually feel like what this one person said. And when it comes to language and that, you can offend, you can offend French people if you say that is French and that's not French. It's, you know, it's always like that, you know. I know that from TV. If you go into Switzerland and the people there speak some sort of German there and you subtitle it, they will get offended because they say they speak German, and the other ones they say, well, but those folks up in Hamburg can't understand what these people say. So okay, well, that's one thing, but comments are obviously very important. And I think what I just mentioned there is you can actually look into what kind of comments you actually want to get. And what I just said with the one video, asking them to actually comment on that, there was one more thing about it, just not only the idea to do it via the YouTube comments, but the other one was to actually look for impact, because I said, tell us how our video in what way changed your life. And that's something more than just the tool of using getting feedback, but to actually get something that your donors should actually like. Because if you get a number of certainly unqualified comments, but you know, you can, they could all be your friends posting that, but in a way you can get some feedback, and maybe people would send you some pictures, you can think of that, or videos, what they actually started the last year. Or you can even start it now. You say, well, please start now, and we will ask that next Christmas again. So start collecting your evidence how we actually changed that. that is something more than just the tool of how to get comments.
In fact, this is as part of the evaluation. In terms of the people that we want to get feedback, I see it as two category. One are those who are watching us, our audience, and another category are the young entrepreneurs who have been featured, because they also have been getting opportunities, or, you know, the videos have impacted their activity.
Yeah.
So in that sense, maybe you can elaborate more, because Inusa got the opportunity to meet the entrepreneurs from Côte d'Ivoire.
Recently, four of them in Côte d'Ivoire. And yeah, first, one of them was even saying that we need to organize a meeting, a kind of forum where we can bring all the entrepreneurs we featured at the same place, where we can discuss together and maybe create something like a kind of forum of, a kind of association of young entrepreneurs. This is really something that themselves asked for us to try to work on it. And I think also we had it in the proposal since the beginning.
Yeah.
But the main thing is also we come to say that we need to, from what they were giving us as feedback, like impact of the video on the activity, we are working currently on short video, like 1 minute, like 90 seconds of video with each of them to say like a kind of short conversation with the journalists to say what the video of Agribusiness TV did on the activity, what happened after the video, and how do they see the future, we need them again for themselves to say it, because even if we have already some idea that they send by email, but we need for them to tell it through video, that we can, it will be like a kind of new content for us that we will have to share with our audience next year.
And there are interesting stories, like some got really big contracts after the video.
With the guy from Chocolate, he's producing like, he's producing 2 tons per year. And after the video, he said that he got contact from Netherlands asking him if he can produce for them 10 tons
per month.
But he does mention in the video already that he has more requests than what he can actually satisfy.
Yeah. That was at the local level. Yeah. But after the video, he got some contact from enterprise in Netherlands contacts him to produce 10 tons per month, which will be like 5 times what he's producing per year. So and now, he's trying to think of new idea, like create some small factory at the level of the producer, so that they can all themselves processing the cocoa and chocolate, so that he can
quickly increase the amount that he can produce.
Yeah. But himself, all this, it is after the video. So it is not that we are saying it is our impact, but it is himself who said it. And
we need to get that on
video. We need to get that on video so that he can give this testimony.
Maybe you can start another little sub-series on people that are just sort of basically in their boots. And you can identify, and then you sort of cover them, how they go along, and you can see if your thing actually has an impact. So if somebody has a good idea and it's just basically starting out, so if you have you thought about that, because you're nodding like that?
I think also we don't need to, we don't want to do like classic television when we talk about someone one time, it is done. You know, people are wondering what is about what has happened with this guy. We hear one time about him and nothing again. We are trying to keep contact with them, asking them to keep us updated on what is happening new in the activity, so that when we will find it is again time to do a new video on the activity, we will do it, so that like kind of follow up, it can be a full story or just a short interview, so that they can give feedback. This is, we need to keep like this permanent contact between with the entrepreneurs and also with our audience, so that they can see how these young entrepreneurs are growing.
Okay, now we over almost 1.5 hours now already. It's great talking to you. You know, I just think we shouldn't go too long. Basically, anything, you know, we spoke about which kind of stories are attractive. Maybe you can say something more, which kind of components. I mean, we know that food is always attractive, but there's also lots of value chain related stories that you cover, that it doesn't have that appeal as such because you can't eat the raw product in between. Yeah, go for it if you want to.
Yeah, I think yeah, one thing we missed on it, I think it is quality, which is also very important. All the videos that we have produced so far, we really have insisted that it is high quality videos, like properly done, like you film it and also properly edited. Like this has been also our reference, and we have been getting feedback also that
and for that we have around like something around 10 stories that we decide not to publish, telling the journalists you missed this one.
So
if you cannot publish, even we pay him, but you don't use the video because it is really not in the way we want it. So yes, this is also
so
something.
Quality is something.
It is really a long process of selection in terms of subject, also when okay. the image came in terms of
sometimes really you get a good subject, but then if you don't cover the subject well it doesn't do justice to that entrepreneur and also to the audience to show a work which is badly done. So one of our major focus is also on quality.
Okay, yeah, good point. So you always have to select a little bit, like
content and quality. This is, I think, the thing about food and all. I think these are supporting things, but the major pillar, I would say, it's the quality and content. These are the two. And
so any area that you want to actually go into that you feel should be covered more, technology, drones, or you know, I don't know,
hydroponics.
Yeah, we will try while we are here to do a video on hydroponics. And now the timing also is not good here because end of year everyone is on holiday. They are either out of country or they are very busy. So right now it's a very difficult time to do a video. But what we really want is innovations like hydroponics, like technology, things that we can adapt also in mainland Africa, which is not there. Because the system is different, the innovation is different. So yeah, we are looking to cover more of these stories, and next year we will also, like we said, we will focus on these things that we propose, the subject, the audience select. We hope it works, but we will try it anyway, see how it goes. And
I think our okay, I be like talking to myself in that way. No, what I want to say, I think our main asset is we are running our own business, so we have the flexibility to decide to try new things, and this is really something that it is different than when you are doing something, working for someone, and you have to do things in that way.
Yeah,
we have that flexibility, the choice to decide what are the new things we really want to try. And
I think this is also so far what has enabled us to try new things.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Did we cover now everything what you want to do next year, or is there anything else?
I think, the evaluation, the short videos of impact,
the TV magazine,
and also production. We will try to keep it 4 videos per month to keep the quality. Like 8 was really, we think it's too much.
That's
it's
what I said from the beginning, it's quite a lot. Eh?
There are also some countries like we may leave because the journalists we have don't really do the work in the quality, required quality.
Mm.
So yes, maybe we'll cover new countries, but also leave some countries because we really want to focus where we think we have some strengths.
Or maybe not leave completely, but we put a pause.
No, but in terms of what type of stories, I mean, I mentioned already value chain, more the raw product. Is that something?
I think it will still cover the different segments.
It will still cover the different segment, but it will also mainly be about the people. About the people.
Their
think the first thing is we did not really get more story about women, but this is also something that was really difficult to find. Yeah, but we'll try to see how to work more on that. But I think also we are trying to cover like people who are not, who are a bit far from the main cities. This is also something. It is we are trying to focus on people first, their story, and then we see what they are. Doing, but at the same time, keep a balance.
But of course, our focus really remains on innovation and new things young people are doing differently. Yeah. It might be anywhere, it might be production itself, or we might cover another one in processing. It really depends on the story.
Yeah.
But we what I think we won't be inclined to do is to repeat the same, because for now, let's say for those who invent tools, we have had quite some now, and I don't think it's worthwhile to show one if it, unless it is really something great that is working and can show something that we haven't shown already. So we want to try to innovate as well. Don't show
but
too
I
much.
Think what we really want is for our audience to see first the people and then the technology or the innovation. This is really what it is about people, it is about someone's stories. This is what
it's
we want
about
them
entrepreneurship.
To see.
It's in the end it's about the story, the inspiration it is giving you.
And also one of the strengths for the video is when you have someone who is really talking very well and telling very well his own story, the video get quickly for the audience, people like to see this kind of video. Some people also are doing nice things, but when it is about telling the story, speaking, it is very, in the end, you don't get enough.
That's exactly a caveat.
I know that from,
oh no, I got a feedback here. I know that, you know, with, I think we spoke about that before, and when I tell clients there and they tell me, no, you must talk to the director of so-and-so, and then I must tell them, listen, I know you work for them, but is that the right person to actually come on camera for the interview? Because, you know, it's difficult. It's hierarchy, but not everybody has the same capacity and comes across on screen. You know, it's not only language, it's the whole appeal. I suppose, eh? It's difficult to find the right people.
Yeah.
It's an old workshop thing. Eh? It's people coming there from the sort of farmers association coming to Europe, and they speak well. All of a sudden, they're on each workshop, and they become the sort of workshop master representing African farmers associations. And then 2 years down the line, you ask yourself, they collected a lot of money. Is that representative in a way that, you know, they, because they are basically coming from one workshop to the next. So it's also, I suppose, an issue for you, you know, because you want to get a good representation. You don't, if somebody is too affluent in a way, then she won't represent the typical woman farming in a way. I don't know how you actually manage to do that, or you.
Yeah, no, but for now, it's, since also it's our choice to keep the person, we keep it. It's we haven't really rejected someone based on the ability of the person to speak.
No.
So far, it's because sometimes someone...
It is just the journalists, they don't like it because it means more work for them. They need to
push the guy to do
it again. So they don't like it because it is more work for them, but
in the end,
it is not a criteria.
Yeah.
And most of the time, it is when we are on the in the field that we notice that the guy is have some. But sometimes also when they are the field and they have this problem, they contact me directly, and I just try to see if the guy is not, if he cannot try in another language, because like this last video on the guy who did the tractor, yeah, he started in French, but the guy was not really having, who was not comfortable. Mm. And I asked the journalist, why don't you do it completely in the local language? But when he started asking the question in the local language,
it changed.
So we know that of course the guy went to school, he studied in French, but he had some problems with French. So when it was about speaking local language, he was explaining very well his story. So this is, we need to try. And
But it's also one of the things we discussed in the workshop we did in February.
Yeah.
We had the journalists participate in this session where we had like scenarios. What if this happens?
What if this happens?
What would you do in this situation?
All these challenges we can face in the field or during our work. We cover most of these situations.
Yeah.
Most of the situation we imagine that in February we face them. Like,
maybe
what if you go in the field and we notice that the guy who you are meeting is not really the one who created the business?
Yeah.
So we faced all these situations also. Yeah.
Okay, now I want to ask maybe one final question. I don't know if Keron, you can obviously come in again. Maybe that might be of interest to you as well, Keron. I don't know if I watched all the videos and if I covered all this the issues there that were covered in the stories, but what about trading, marketing, those classic things, you know, that the sales component? You have, I think, a lot of production on that side, but obviously things that are sold and marketed, or, you know, classic sales and that, is there anything in that regard? You know, people that make a living out of, you know, basically taking stuff, retail and all that on that side without the production. I don't know if I missed a story on that, but I can't.
Yeah, we have one.
Okay.
The one we have one from Mauritius, and yeah, they have a shop nearby here. In fact, this is how we discovered them. We were walking to the supermarket and we saw a nice shop, super nice building.
Only vegetables.
Only vegetables, like fruits and vegetables, really high quality. This is how we got interested in first in the shop. Then when we inquired, we got to know that the business was started by two brothers. So we talked to them. We didn't know anyone. We went in the shop. We asked who is the owner. And one of the employees put us in touch with the owner. No, we were mostly in touch with him. He was in touch with the boss. So in the end, we did a video on them. What they do is that they market fruit and vegetables to hotels in Mauritius.
Mm-hmm.
Like 40 to 60 hotels, and these are really big hotels, like all four or five star hotels. And their product is just the first premium quality fruits and vegetables. They are just in marketing. They get local products, local fruit and vegetables, and also those who are imported, because in hotels you need things like oranges or things that you don't grow in Mauritius or not in season, but in hotels they still need it. So they market, they take local products, they market it to hotels, or they also import based on the season. If it is not in the country, they import and they market. Their main activity is marketing, and now they have like over 150 employees, and we visited their office, really big office, goods. Really good.
But they really start like
they started very small, and this was an inspiring story for us to show that, you know, you can start from nothing and this is where you can reach. So this the marketing, I would say this is one of our strong story that we have on Agribusiness TV, that shows that you can be at this part of the value chain and your business is here.
And also, there is also some challenging in some African country, like this story from Mali, with the guy who is producing milk. He said himself, the ideal situation for him was just to produce the milk and give it someone to
process it,
to process and market it. But the situation is he has to do everything himself, like produce milk, transport milk, process it, and sell it.
Else
there is no one to do it. But if there are other companies like just here taking production from other and processing and selling, he will be interested.
Mm.
So this is also why most of the story we are covering, most of in terms of product production, the entrepreneurs are doing even the marketing themselves.
Here, I would say there is a value chain issue.
In
Mali, it is very clear that in terms of marketing, the value chain itself is not developed in the country. And he also mentioned several political reasons, so we won't get into details into that. But
Okay, Keron, it's your subject, hey? You want to come in on that finally?
In terms of marketing, the closest that Tech4Agri has come to something like that was to feature an episode sort of that was in a conversational mode and assisting an institution in Guyana and giving them advice on how to use social media properly, because they needed to improve what content they were putting out on their channels, and they also really wanted to reach those younger persons to really try to build some community engagement around what the institution is doing and try to really form a connection with them, with their audience. So we did an episode where we had some shots of activities of the organization mixed in with shots of a conversation that we had, where we basically gave advice and explained how beneficial social media could be used. Now, it might be much, but here in the Caribbean, social media is used in everything except agriculture. It's literally everywhere except in the agricultural sphere. So really, for us, showing how useful it can be really helps to kind of upgrade the sector in general, because people are using it and don't realize how to use it properly.
Mm.
So you have not just institutions, but people who have small businesses that are all they have is a Facebook page or an Instagram account, and that's the only online presence they have, and that's all they use to get orders and actually get business. So, and then they are just basically doing what they think is good, whereas that we can teach to help these persons with their marketing and with their online presence. So that's the closest we've come. It's something that we want to look at in the future, since we do provide that service as well outside of the web series. So we'll see how that goes. We will see what the feedback is like when that episode is online. We haven't really put it online as yet. So for us, it will be, we started off with a survey to kind of get feedback as to what people want to learn about. So if it's marketing or technology or something very specific. And so we have these groups of topics, and from there we will use that to get more feedback to kind of guide the next season. So that's it.
Good. And it's interesting. Yeah, well, we have to cover your outfit there in one of our hangouts in the future as well. But then for that you will have to come on with a camera. Anyway, 1.5 hours. It's your final word. Do you want to wrap this up? Tell us where you're going. Are you going to do monetization, getting away from CTA and just finance your whole thing yourself and get those little funny yellow spots into the videos that mean that you that you get advertisement revenue, or where are you going? Keep it short and smooth.
Where I'm going? I think for the job you are doing, and we need to find other ways to keep producing new content. So like funding, like from CTA, was very important for us to start. But to be really keep our credibility, we need to find ways to keep it going without this way of funding, without these grants. And this is really what we need to the proof we need to bring for 2017, that it is possible to raise to raise fund in other ways apart from grants. This is really a choice we are making, and
I think we let's say 2016 it was about showing what we can produce and what kind of engagement we can bring. 2017 will be also about testing how publicity works. Because now, let's say before we were coming with concept, explaining to people what we want to do, but now we have something that we can show them already. We have numbers that we can, we are more in a position, I would say, position of power to negotiate now and we can show already that we have an audience on our platforms, and this can encourage more publicity. So we will see how to use this as a strength to get publicity on our platform. And we have to experiment to see how it works. It might work, it might not work, but yes, it is one of the big options we want.
It has to work. The main message is just to say that producing videos has a cost. And we don't want the entrepreneur to pay that, so someone else need to pay it. So this is what you need to find, and it can, you don't want it also to keep being grants.
Because the idea is to move away from the grant and make it sustainable.
So have you considered turning on monetization on YouTube? I don't know if there's a similar feature on Facebook. I don't do Facebook usually. You know what I mean? Turning on monetization on Facebook, on YouTube.
Yeah, this can be an option, but it will, I think, what we are working on will be a kind of combination of several platforms.
And we'll do it as a test, like go little by little, see how it works, not accept everywhere publicity, and also type of publicity. We need to be careful what goes there and how to do it. So I don't have a lot of prior experience with publicity, so we have to also plan, have a good strategy and see what will work best for us. But yes, we will try.
We don't know how it will be, but at least we know what we don't want to do, so I think this is already something good.
Okay, if that's your final word, I would say we keep it with that. I wish you a very good new year, and I'll speak to you again, I suppose, in about half a year. I hope that my new setup here has worked, because they were obviously, every time you change, because this blab didn't work all of a sudden. I hope that the recording worked well. If that's the case, I will just put it up next couple of days with slight edit, and then you can share it as well. Okay,
so
should we keep it like that, Keron?
Yep.
Keron, you still there? Okay. Okay. All right,
see you guys.
Let's cheers.
Happy
bye
New
bye
Year.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, happy
to
New
you
Year.
Too
bye.